A celebration of some of the greatest rivalries in the history of sport now on BBC Two, presenting a new series, Clash of the Titans.
Last of the great romantic drivers on the Grand Prix circuit, a dashing adventurer in the cockpit of his McLaren.
James in another life would have for certainly been a sort of World War I fighter pilot.
Yeah, I never hit anybody, I stopped on the left, and the explosion came and fired into me.
His rival, Niki Lauda, was the reigning world champion, the man they called the computer brain.
Niki is the first driver of the new generation, of the bionic drivers, of really motivated, dedicated full-time to the competition.
In 1976, they fought for the world championship title in one of the most ferocious battles the Grand Prix racing has ever seen. A cavalcade fit for a president glides through the streets of Sao Paulo in Brazil. At its head, twice world champion Emerson Fittipaldi, lauded as the nation's sporting hero and Brazilian championship hope for 1976. But at the Interlagos Stadium, where the first race of the season is being held, the big news is that the new boy in the McLaren, James Hunt, is fast and has made it to pole position.
There was absolutely no way that James was going to be world champion in 1976 at the beginning of the season. James Hunt hadn't even been going to drive for McLaren. He'd won one race with Fisker and was facing absolutely nothing.
His reputation off the track read like a torrid novel, a charming but deadly boy racer with a weakness for the opposite sex. His status in the jet set was confirmed when he married the beautiful model Susie Miller, and for a while they were the golden couple of Formula One.
It was so nice to have James in the Formula One, because it was like a gypsy, like a hippie, I don't know, with short blue jeans, without shoes, and smoking in the pits, relaxed. And it was a completely different world. I'm not blind to
him. And he drove like he romanced, at full throttle, and appeared to be just as reckless, crashing cars and earning the nickname Hunt the Shunt.
I got this reputation quite right when I was driving in Formula 3.
Fellow drivers often fell foul of Hunt's temper. After a collision with Dave Morgan, Hunt took a swing at him.
That was a typical example of what James was like. He used to get tremendously wound up before and during a race. The adrenaline would flow in buckets. He used to go away before he got in the car very often, especially in his Formula One days, and literally be sick.
James, at the start of a race, would sit in the car, and if you sat on the side of the car, you would think the engine was running because the car was vibrating all the time, literally shaking. The whole structure of the car was rattling. And this wasn't fear. He was just so charged up that this translated into this fantastic engine.
There were no such vibrations coming from the cockpit of Lauda's Ferrari, only conspicuous signs of a consummate skill, demonstrated on the most tricky of circuits, like Monte Carlo. He was world championship material from the moment he joined the Ferrari team.
There's no question that in 75, 76, I was really dominating the whole thing without any mistakes, so I did nothing wrong. I mean, this was perfect driving.
So, at that first race of the season, Hunt and Lauda were side by side on the grid, but not for long, as Lauda immediately took the lead. First races are always chaos. New drivers in new cars are an explosive combination. as Hunt was to find out when a fuel injection trumpet from his McLaren unexpectedly fell off, jamming the throttle open. For Lauda, it was the easiest of wins, and he went on to take a commanding early lead in the championship. Spurred on by Ferrari's motto that perfection does not exist, only the evolution towards it, Lauda won 5 out of the first 6 races, gaining 51 points to Hunt's meagre 6. The only time Hunt was able to mount a challenge was in Spain. To the relief of everyone in the McLaren team, he took the checkered flag.
Just a minute, I haven't done my hair yet. I'm not ready to go on the telly. Can you get the wardrobe along?
Congratulations. How much have you got in hand?
Well, I had to work very hard for the first half of the race. I thought Niki was very brave. You know, he drove really well.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
But even here, Hunt's victory was short-lived. At the moment he received his laurels, the authorities were about to disqualify him. The McLaren was too wide.
What do you see as the issue at stake, Teddy, with this disqualification?
Well, I think really, Erwin, the penalty is just too harsh. That the infringement was very minor, and suddenly they've come down on us like a ton of bricks, and there's no real reason to do that.
When the winner stops, his car and some of the others go into the Parc Fermé, and they are scrutineered to make sure that they comply with the regulations. When they measured James's car, they found that it was 1.8 centimetres too wide. Now, that is about the width of your little finger.
I flew home after the race, after being in hospital, and over Geneva I said to the pilots, ask the ATC control, which is the talk to the airplanes, who won the Spanish Grand Prix. So they said, Lauda, because Hunt got disqualified. So James' car was too wide, and they chucked him out, and I was even finishing second on the paper, won the race afterwards. So from this point of view, everything went fine.
But for the reigning world champion with the unassailable lead, there was one track that Lauda feared, and he called a meeting of his fellow drivers to enlist their support in having it removed from the Grand Prix calendar. That circuit was the Nürburgring in Germany.
And I said, the cars are going to go too quick. This circuit cannot be maintained to today's standards. I don't think we should race there.
The start of the German Grand Prix on the famous Nürburgring track. 20 roaring monsters, but only a few of them matter.
Carved out of the Eifel Mountains in the 1930s, Nürburgring was 14.2 miles long and narrow. Fine motoring for vintage races, but deadly when speeds were an average of 112 miles per hour. By 1976, 63 drivers had perished in Grand Prix motor racing. That year, drivers had a 1 in 15 chance of surviving the season. And every driver remembered with chilling clarity the desperate attempts by David Purley to rescue his dying friend Roger Williamson from his burning car, working alone while no one seemed willing or able to help him. Old photographs read like a roll call of the doomed. Peterson dead, Depailler dead, Regazzoni paralyzed from the waist down. Niki Lauda didn't want to go the same way, especially not at the Nürburgring.
The other guys argued and said, but we gave them a 3-year deal on modifying the circuit and we're going to race there for 3 years and this is the last year. So anyway, we did a vote on that and I was outvoted because the other guys said, no, we have to respect the 3-year deal.
How many lives have we lost needlessly from suffocation, things like that, where the guy didn't have a broken bone? You know, these were the terrible 70s as we know them.
When you sit in the cockpit, you have to concentrate, focus on racing. But going home with your wife, see your family or kids, you're asking yourself, I'm going to be the next one in line? What's going to happen to me next time?
So they would go to the Nürburgring one more time. But first, France. And as the Grand Prix circus rolled into the Ricard Stadium, with Niki Lauda so far ahead, there was, finally, a glimmer of hope from the McLaren camp. A tiny technical problem, which had plagued them for several races, had at last been solved.
Niki started doing the winning, and he's kept the habit, and I've been just behind him. But it only, you know, it just needs the straw to break the camel's back.
So Hunt and Lauda were together again at the front of the grid. 47 points separated their scores, but technically at least, Hunt was on an equal footing. And this time, it was Lauda's turn to be plagued by engine trouble.
The whole car just blocked. I was sliding along and then, you know, just blew up the engine. Terrible luck. I'm upset, but look at it.
Gleefully, Hunt took the checkered flag. That same weekend, he learned that he and McLaren had won their appeal over the Spanish Grand Prix, regaining another 9 points. They were still 26 points behind Lauda, but catching up.
They had had a problem with the positioning of the oil cooler, a terribly trivial thing, which in fact had made such a dramatic change to the aerodynamics of the car that it made the handling terrible. And by a process of trial and error, they discovered what the problem was, moved the oil coolers about an inch, that's all it was. The car's handling was transformed, and from then on, James and the McLaren team didn't look back.
The Grand Prix Charabanc cruised into Britain to be greeted by one of the hottest summers on record. James Hunt signed on as the nation's new sporting hero. He rose to the occasion with an appearance at the Albert Hall.
Mr. Hunt, you're very fond of blowing your own trumpet, aren't you?
Hunt passed the test as a sporting celebrity, and the anecdotes flowed forth. And of course, like all racers, he passed his driving test on his 17th birthday.
I passed my test straight away, conned the exam. I drove beautifully at sort of 25 miles, 27 miles an hour, I think you're supposed to in the test, and did all my hand signals, dropped the examiner off with my pink slip, dropped the clutch, and went absolutely flat out all the way home, and never lifted for about a year after that. Everything was absolutely flat out, and everybody else on the road was a potential person to race. I couldn't understand why I always won, though. It didn't actually occur to me at that stage that other people didn't want to race me. I thought they all wanted to race.
He was always a rebel.
Yes.
Yes, yes, yes. He didn't take to authority kindly at all. Always wanted to have his own way, and usually got it.
Well, I think he was testing the ground.
Yes.
James Hunt's route into Formula One involved a collision with another rebel, Lord Alexander Hesketh, the only private sponsor in the field.
We thought they were a lot of raving, mad, aristocratic idiots.
There was an element of cocking a snoop at our opponents, partly because they thought we were ridiculous, probably for very understandable reasons. And then after a while, we thought, well, actually, we're not as bad as people say we are. We might have the ability to be competitive. At which point, we put our heads down and really pushed hard.
Hard enough to win the Dutch Grand Prix in 1975, a triumph. But even as the Hesketh team were congratulating themselves, the money had run out. They were broke. If Hunt hadn't been picked by McLaren, he might not be driving at all. But he never forgot his friends.
Really, they did everything for me. I mean, they brought me up, they put me in a Grand Prix car, gave me an opportunity, and I think it was a great tragedy for motorsport and for British sport in particular that at a time when the team was really getting very good and had just, you know, as a group, got the whole thing together and were looking forward to the best possible season that we could have, that we ran out of bread.
A record 77,000 people travelled to Brands Hatch for the British Grand Prix. All of them wanted to see the young British driver, James Hunt, win. But the race was to become one of the biggest controversies of the season.
The start was reasonably normal. James got away quite well. And the two Ferraris had been on the front row had tangled themselves together in paddock bend. James really had nowhere to go and clipped one of them. So he was limping around to come in and be able to effect some repairs.
He came in through a little gap on the track into the pits at the back along Cooper Strait and went back to his garage.
I got out of trouble completely. I never hit anybody. I stopped on the left and they fucking came and piled into me.
In the meantime, the stewards were saying he might not be allowed to restart. So I was in the building behind us arguing with them about that while Alistair Caldwell and our mechanics repaired the car.
Because James hadn't actually completed on the track a lap to get back to the pits, he wasn't going to be allowed to start. And it was at this point that the clamour began.
A crowd, sensing that there might be something going on, was screaming and yelling, "We want Hunt, we want Hunt."
So they decided that they would let everybody restart.
As lap 45 begins,
Hunt Lauda led until the 45th lap, when Hunt disappeared behind the trees in second place and reappeared the leader. At last, the crowd got what they wanted. But history was about to repeat itself.
James won the race fair and square, only to find later on that the Ferrari had protested.
The rules, as far as I'm concerned, and still are, and I don't have a copy but with me these days, but they said that the driver had to be taking part in the original race when it was stopped. It didn't say he had to complete the first lap or any lap.
I am sure Teddy Mayer would have done the same against Ferrari because the rules allow him to do it. So was my job to protest because James took the shortcut.
The next race was at Nürburgring in Germany, the track that Lauda had hoped his fellow drivers would boycott. To add to the dangers, the circuit was half wet, half dry.
Nürburgring, the major problem had was the weather, like today, you know, can rain. One part of Nürburgring be dry and using slick tires. If you get on a damp part, you have zero chance to recover.
Niki decided to change the tires from wet to dry very soon, one of the first. That strategically was a very good move, but unfortunately, the circuit was still wet.
And then I went out of the pit behind Carlos Pacheco, this I remember very well. And I said, shit, now I have to follow the guy all the way around, where I lose a lot of time. And then my memory stops.
What happened next has entered Grand Prix history.
Well, having just climbed out of Adenauer Bridge, I could see in the distance there was black smoke, which usually meant a pretty ominous sign that a car had caught fire.
Lauda was trapped in a ball of flame. It wasn't until his old adversary, Arturo Mezzario, arrived on the scene and undid Lauda's belt that he was freed from the wreckage. He'd been breathing fumes for nearly a minute.
We got him up, actually walked him away from where his car was and where he was. I put his head on my lap, didn't want him to lie flat. But he was conscious and talked all the way through. In fact, he asked me, he said, "What's my face? Is it burned? Is it burned?" I replied, "No, no, don't worry about it, it's okay." In fact, his forehead was badly burned and one ear was badly burned. His scalp was actually charred. Rather than telling him all this, we just tried to keep him as quiet and composed as possible and wait for the medical services to arrive. That was just an illustration of what the problems were at the Nürburgring. It took a long time, as opposed to where we are now, where I think it is mandatory that you've got services within, I think it's a minute or so of any incident. This was 5-6 minutes.
While Lauda was flown to hospital, the race restarted. James Hunt was the victor, but the celebrations were dampened by the news that Lauda's condition was much worse than everyone feared. Doctors believed his lungs were beyond repair.
The biggest problem was that they discussed openly amongst themselves about my condition. And they said, if we give him oxygen, he's going to die. If we're going to do this, we don't know. And I mean, I heard everything. I told him afterwards. I mean, it's ridiculous. And then at a later time, Marlene came, and she started crying and screaming. So I said, Jesus Christ, I mean, I must really be in terrible condition if everybody freaks out here. So then I really don't remember, because the timing, I can't recall, because I couldn't look, I couldn't see, I didn't know it was day or night and whatever. But then I felt after, maybe it was Sunday night or Monday, that the pain and the whole thing just gets too much. And I saw myself completely happy and relaxed, falling down backwards into nowhere. And in the same moment, I got so frightened. I said, what's going on now? So I said, if I let go now, I think I'm going to die, because my body is not able anymore to cope with all these burns, and lung damage was the biggest problem. So I do something, do something. So I was thinking of, what can I do now? So I was trying to listen to the nurses' talks and doctors' talks and try to concentrate and stay with them to not fall back and lean back and die. So I think that helped me. I mean, I said, I'm going to fight whatever I can do to stay alive.
Lauda clung on and within 5 days was off the danger list. Meanwhile, Enzo Ferrari, the godfather of Italian racing, was already looking for a replacement driver.
I was talking to the doctors next to Nick's here at intensive care, really bad injury. And, you know, they call me on the side of the Ferrari people and say, Emerson, do you want to join Ferrari? And I'm trying to see if my friend is going to recover. I mean, I was shocked.
That is a ruthless job. Our job, because you have your top driver that is fighting for life, but you have to carry on.
If a driver gets injured so that he can't drive or killed, sure, there's genuine remorse, everybody turns up at the funeral and feels bad and so on, especially if it's a married man or something, but they also straight away calculate how this shifts the chess game, how the pieces fit together now with one piece missing, with especially if it's a king or a queen, you know, a major player been taken out by an accident, then all the others, all the pawns, all shuffle up, all excited.
For the next two races, the pretenders lined up on the grid. Hunt saw everyone else off and won the Dutch Grand Prix. With 5 wins behind him, Hunt now had a total of 56 points, just 2 points behind Lauda.
For James Hunt, it was not only a great victory, but a great way to celebrate his 29th birthday.
Well, it's a nice position to be in, but it doesn't half put the pressure on.
James was doing very well, because when I was in the hospital, he won a couple of races. I mean, this was my biggest fear, because I was so much in the lead, and he was just catching up like crazy.
Lauda could wait no longer. He arrived at the offices of Ferrari in full view of the press. Embarrassingly, they'd already hired another driver, Carlos Reutemann. In truth, they wanted Lauda to bow out a hero, and perhaps it was too early. On his first practice 6 weeks after the accident, he had a panic attack.
First day I went out of the pits, I couldn't change into second gear because I was so frightened that I couldn't drive. So the fear just hit me and I couldn't drive. So I did a slow lap, back into the pits and had to stop. By Saturday morning, I said, I'm going to go to this practice on my own. I don't even care that there is the Italian Grand Prix. I build up my speed slowly, my confidence slowly, and see what I can do. So I did very slow laps, and then slowly quicker and quicker and quicker, and finally, I was quickest Ferrari.
But Lauda's comeback at Monza in Italy was about to be overshadowed by another Grand Prix scandal, as the Italian racing authorities homed in on McLaren.
I went to the racetrack with Teddy and the drivers and turned up at probably 10 or something in the morning and got arrested. Carbonari were there with machine guns and marched me off to jail. It turned out that they were accusing McLarens of importing the fuel illegally, and I was being done for smuggling. Meanwhile, the stewards had taken Teddy up to the stewards' office at Monza and said they'd tested the fuel was illegal, and that we were to be disqualified.
So, while Lauda took his place at the front of the grid, Hunt was facing a punitive relegation to the back of it for importing the so-called drugged fuel.
We even said, look, let us start the race, you know, in our proper position. If we can't prove that the fuel is legal to you, then we'll just disqualify us, take it away. And they wouldn't even do that.
Humiliated, Hunt took his position at the rear with virtually no chance of winning. In a furious lunge, he tried to overtake from the inside and was out.
This partisan Italian crowd cheers for only two things today, a Ferrari passing a competitor or their most serious challenger to the world championship in trouble. Here it is, the latter. England's James Hunt is out after coming off the road in second chicane.
The crowd, when James had to walk back, were derisive, you know, as only Italian cars could be, spitting and throwing things and screaming at him. But pleased he was out of the race. But when we got back to the pits, the atmosphere was so bad that we decided to leave. And they attacked the car, and dented the car, and banged on the car, and tried to tip it over and so on.
Instead of jeers, there were cheers for the number one Ferrari as Lauda passed the line in fourth place. The Italian crowd got what they wanted, but James Hunt was outraged.
They didn't just try and put us out of the race. They also attempted to humiliate us by putting us at the back of the grid and trying to make us make idiots of ourselves, which is very difficult not to do from there if you're trying to charge.
You see it, do you, clearly, as yourself against Ferrari now? It's no, become that, has it?
No, Harry, I see it as myself getting on racing, and that's how I want to see it, and I see it myself. I would like to see it as myself having a battle with Niki.
The fuel of McLaren was not legal. That's the point. Because otherwise you don't have rules. If we have rules, you have to respect rules.
They were very excited about this English mafiosa who'd used the illegal fuel and so on, which of course wasn't illegal, never was. There wasn't even a hint of being illegal. In fact, on Monday morning, the Italian authorities apologized to Texaco and McLaren's for this, but too late.
Blooded and bowed, the McLaren team travelled to Canada with the appeal over the British Grand Prix still hanging over their heads. Then the worst possible news. Ferrari's protests had been upheld. McLaren lost the appeal and the 9 points. Now they were 17 points behind.
For the ordinary motor racing fan, it seems that this season the whole thing is being decided by committee. You know, rules and regulations proliferating. I mean, what do the drivers think about it all?
Well, I think everybody thinks it's a disaster. Apart from anything else, they've just written off the World Championship. They've devalued it, totally said it's now meaningless.
We've just pulled off the tapes here in London as I've been talking to you, a quote from Niki Lauda. He has reacted to the news, quite understandably, by saying, I'm delighted, madly delighted. Now, what do you say to that?
Well, it's the sort of rubbish you'd expect. Niki isn't a sportsman. Niki's interested in any one thing, and that's Niki.
Anybody would admit we couldn't possibly win the World Championship now. Niki was back, he was well, Ferraris were in good form. We had three races to go and we were all these points behind Ferrari. We were hopeless, it was just hopeless. So we gave up. Meanwhile, James went completely ape, lost all discipline. He was difficult to discipline at the best of times. I used to have trouble keeping him in line, making him go to bed, stay away from women and booze and so on. But now we'd lost the 9 points, then the World Championship was a hopeless quest. So I let James go. I didn't control James anymore. I used to try and control him, but I didn't try and control him. So I don't know when he went to bed, but it was certainly in the early hours of the morning, very drunk, and probably not alone. But the rest is history, and the fact that, of course, he won the race easily.
Against all odds, Hunt took the race, but he still had to win the next two races and have Lauda do no better than third place to gain the championship. An impossible task, and at their hotel in Watkins Glen, America, Lauda could hardly hide his confidence.
At 7:45 in the morning, when I was still asleep, there was a great banging on the interconnecting door of my room. So I went and opened it, and there was Niki, already in his overalls, marching into my room and saying, morning, I'm going to be the world champion today. Which succeeded in putting me in an enormous twitch right through breakfast, but by the time breakfast finished, that I was all right and back down to business. Because it was a pretty hefty experience, first thing in the morning on Sunday, gets you thinking. It was I thought that was one of the best things he ever did.
Oh, foolish. Hunt won, leaving Lauda to eat his words in third place. Now, with 3 points between them, the championship will be decided in the last race beneath Mount Fuji in Japan. On the day of the race, the rains came.
When it rains in Japan, it is like a monsoon. So the track was flooded.
It was like Niagara Falls, you know, it was really impossible to see. And the drivers had the meeting before the race, and everybody agreed not to race if the rain was still so heavy.
Basically, the organizers agreed with us until 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and then they said, now it's going to be dark in 2 hours. We need to start the race now. So I said, what the hell is different? The rain is the same. You're still flooded. We can't do it. They said, we're going to start now.
I mean, that first lap, the first 200 yards, I mean, you couldn't see a car. You could see the lead car, and that was all you could see.
The car out in front happened to be James Hunt.
Oh, but look at that car snaking now. Those are the conditions. A tight right underneath, one tiny little bit of pressure, and that's how dangerous it is.
The car was just aquaplaning. There was losing contact to the track. I mean, there was... You need a rudder instead of a wheel on the car to control it. It was like a boat.
Right by Van Miller, and Van Miller spins! And he missed Hunt by inches!
Then the news spread through the pits. Lauda was out.
I pulled out, and Fittipaldi pulled out, Pace pulled out, I think 3 or 4 guys just stopped right away in the beginning because we said we can't accept that.
Niki Lauda talks to Daniel Ordetto, the Ferrari team manager, and says the conditions out there are too bad, I've had enough, and who can blame him?
When he came into the pits, you can really see his face that was really blocked because he saw in this condition, maybe, he cannot admit, but he see the same condition of Nürburgring, even if it was not so much rain, but was wet, was dangerous. And you cannot force a driver to go against his feeling, because then you really kill somebody.
He said, what's wrong? I said, I'm not driving. So he said, you get out and say the engine is broken. So in the same second, I said, that's a good story. But then I said, no, there's no way I can do that, because it would fire back on me, because if the engine is perfect, it was me who didn't want to drive.
So, Jochen Maas now...
Back on the track, the cars were falling like ninepins.
No doubt about that. Look at the stricken McLaren drawing to a standstill.
The French driver, Patrick Depailler, had snatched the lead from Hunt, who had been ignoring pit signals and blown 2 tyres.
Literally 2 flat tyres. And we went past and we could see him. The car was dragging on the ground. Sparks were coming out underneath. Chung, chung, chung. So we knew he was coming in.
And Hunt! Hunt is in the pits in second place. And if he drops below 4, if he goes out, his world championship is going to be in danger. What an incredible change of fortune.
We had a bit of a struggle getting a jack under the car. In fact, Howard Moore, one of his mechanics, had to actually pick the corner of the car up bodily, which is quite hard to do.
Hunt is still in the pits, and there are 2 wheels changed. The engine is going to fire, and James Hunt gets away. Now he is in 5th position and out of the contention.
When he left the pit road, he was no longer world champion and had no chance of being, because though he was going to go faster on the new tyres, it wouldn't be fast enough to catch them. There wasn't that long left in the race.
And it came to literally to the last lap.
This brilliant American who has won one, and James Hunt is passing Jones. Hunt is 4, and Regazzoni is out of the race, so now Hunt moves up to 3rd position. And Mario Andretti coming up to take the checkered flag and win the 1976 Japanese Grand Prix, and he does it.
And he came in, I think, 3rd, but at that stage we had no idea. So as he got out the car, convinced he'd lost by 1 place the world title, all he wanted to do is have a go.
James had his helmet on, and there was a lot of crowd noise around. and he couldn't hear me, and he was berating me. And I'm screaming, "You won, you won."
I certainly wasn't going to believe that, because I knew they were confused, and I didn't want to believe anything till I was sure. I didn't want to get disappointed again. I'd had enough of those all year without doing it on the big one. So I suppose it took about half an hour.
The one person who had yet to hear the news was Niki Lauda, now on his way to the airport.
When we arrived at the airport and we went under the runway, they said, "And now we have the result of the Japanese Grand Prix." Boom, the radio stopped, because the guy was going in the tunnel. So when we came out on the other end, we did not know again what the hell was going on. So, but then when we arrived at the airport, there was the Ferrari importer there waiting for us. And I saw his face and I knew, shit, you know, something must have gone wrong. And then he confirmed us that I was second and not first.
Both James and Niki deserve to win the season. Ideally, I would like to say that we had a tour champion this year, Niki and James.
James Hunt returned to Britain the world champion and took up his seat on the celebrity roller coaster.
Wait a tick. Off a mo. Stone me, you're David Bailey, aren't you?
No, no, I'm sorry, I'm not Bailey. Listen, I think you are me.
Look, chum, I'm talking to the engineer, not the oily rag.
Britain's world motor racing champion, James Hunt.
Yeah. What about a tip then?
Certainly. Leave the woman alone.
Yeah, now how are you really coping with the razzmatazz of being the champion? You're still in there pitching and punching, they tell me.
Well, it's pretty heavy, right, quite honestly. I've had 2 weekends at home since Japan, and that's it. And I've been, the rest of the time, I've just been traveling around, and it's been a lot of flying, a lot of things, and the problem's been always in, you know, in the public eye.
James was not the sort of person who actually liked the adulation and people fawning and swarming around him. He was an Englishman's Englishman. He wanted to be in the pub and have a pint and talk to his mate.
The day job wasn't going too well either. The new McLaren car was poor, and Hunt was finding it hard to win races.
And Hunt has pushed off, and a burst of flame as they go into the chicane.
Then, in 1978, he and his close friend, Ronnie Peterson, were involved in a multiple pile-up at Monza. Hunt pulled the dying driver from his car.
Peterson's Lotus 78 that's in flames, and there is Peterson. He's been pulled out by James Hunt. He was trapped, and James Hunt, and I can see Regazzoni down there. I can see Daly down there. And meantime, the Italian firefighters getting on top of those flames.
James was completely shaken up by that. The reason he was shaken, he said it was just so awful because the fear. He said Ronnie knew he was going to die, you know, and he could see it on his face. That really shocked him. And he was very, very concerned that if anything should happen to him, that he didn't want to be a vegetable or any of those other things.
No one knew a year later in Monte Carlo that it would be Hunt's last race. Neither did he, but it was.
Now, I could see him in my mind getting out of the car, that sort of hunch, rounded shoulder stance of his, and just literally walking away. And we thought he was walking away from the car, but of course he was walking away from Formula One.
I don't really stand a chance of winning a race this year, and on that basis, for me, the risk is too great than to drive for sixth place. I'm interested in driving to win, but not more than that. So unfortunately, I felt that with the danger and things, I've had to knock it on the head.
Lauda enjoyed a long career, winning the championship again in 1977 and 84. And today, he's still a competitor, fighting battles as entrepreneur and president of Lauda Air.
What I learned very early in my career was that when you win, that everybody's behind you. And when you lose, everybody's against you. So the best thing is to stay in the middle, to believe in yourself, and not when cloud seven comes and you win the world champion, you just take off and you start flying, because the landing can be hard.
Unlike his rival, Hunt never enjoyed a long career as a driver. He did have a successful partnership as a commentator with Murray Walker, but other business ventures failed. He found happiness through his sons, Tom and Freddie. But as with his racing career, this too was short-lived. In 1993, he died in bed of a heart attack at the age of 45.
I was very proud of him, that he won so many races and so many cups, and we still got loads of his trophies at home, like there's a huge champagne bottle that hasn't been opened yet. There's like a gold champagne bottle, which is about that big, with his name engraved on it. And I'm just really proud of him.
At 9:45 next week, the clash between Borg and McEnroe.